Right, hello there. How are you doing? Mambo Vipi. He is hoping that all is well with you from wherever you are watching us. This is In Focus, a program that comes to you every Sunday from 9 p.m. And right here on In Focus, we put a focus on current affairs issues and the budding issues of the day from different sectors. My name, as always, is Eugene. Anangwe. Now in the program today, politics and politics aside, we are focusing on a very major social issue, and that is marriages and divorce. What are the causes of divorce? And of course, how do we handle this particular issue? We have a great panel right here of experts on this particular matter, and they'll be sharing with us their thoughts on this one. Now, this is a very interactive program. We've been trending so far at number one. Keep those thoughts coming. The hashtag, you do not need to tag me on those tweets or RBA Rwanda. All you need to do is simply add the hashtag InFocusRW. That's where I'll be focusing on to be able to track your tweets and read them right here on the program. So keep them coming. And of course, in just a bit, I'll be introducing our power panel. Stay with us. Right. Thank you so much for joining us on In Focus. Of course, right here with us on the program, we have brought in experts and, of course, those who usually talk about this particular matter with their congregations. And one of them is none other than Pastor Ayobami Oladapo, who is the country coordinator, Redeemed Christian Church of God. Thank you for joining us on In Focus.
Thank you.
Also with us on the program is Mary Kamanzi, who's the founder of Arise and Shine School and national coordinator or director of the Youth with a Mission for Rwanda. Thank you for joining us on the program. You also head the Ministry of Marriage at Christian Life Assembly. Thank you for joining us on the program.
Thank you.
Also with us on the program is Pastor John Gatera, Living Church of Christ, together with your wife. You usually work with couples in marriage issues and also prepare youth for marriage. You have actually also authored a book called Can Marriage Be Successful? Thank you for joining us on the program.
Welcome.
29 years in marriage,
yes.
Right?
Yes.
And when we tweeted this, someone was actually saying, 29 only. Let's start from there.
Yeah.
What does it take to get to 29 years in marriage?
Well, I would say that what it takes to get there is the willingness to be together, mm-hmm. to remain faithful to the marriage covenant, mm-hmm. to understand each other, mm-hmm. in love, of course. Mm-hmm. It doesn't mean that everything is perfect. Mm-hmm. But we have learned to work out our differences and, you know, in love, patience, you know.
That's right.
And supporting each other, mm-hmm. because in marriage people have certainly to agree on a number of issues.
That's right.
As well as agreeing to disagree on certain mm-hmm. other issues.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
And then be able to find a way forward.
You make it sound so easy, but this is actually not what happens in many marriages. They are breaking off. People are divorcing. Why?
Well, people might be struggling with, first of all, understanding each other. Mm-hmm. In my own opinion, the experience I've had with couples that we have worked with, a number of people don't really take time to prepare for marriage.
That's right.
People just land into marriage. They don't take time to understand who. Like for example, the courses we give to the young people who prepare for marriage, mm. we take them through know better the person you want to marry.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it's very funny that some people. They go through courtship on Facebook, on WhatsApp,
uh-huh.
but the people need to understand exactly who are you getting married to, uh-huh. because you are going to be engaged in a lifelong journey,
uh-huh.
and then if this is not taken care of, usually there will be problems.
It leads to problems.
Yeah.
Mary, first of all, on the 29 years and how, you know, he ends up being in that particular commitment 29 years later, how he makes it sound so easy and so, you know, piece of cake. But at the end of the day, we have people breaking up. And he talks of people don't take time to know each other. But a young person who's preparing to get married is wondering, what is time? How long should the courtship be? Because we have some girls or boys out there who say, you're playing with my mind, you know, when are you going to propose? When are you going to marry me to make me feel like you're serious and committed in this marriage?
Yeah. Maybe I should start by saying I actually beat him 1 year.
Oh,
because I'm
30?
Already 30 years wow. married. And the question of how long, actually, that, there's no formula. There's no formula of you must court or for this long. For some people, it takes a shorter time. For some people, it takes longer time. But definitely, the issue of playing with one another is wrong, mm-hmm. and it creates pain and hurt. And actually, in the couple, the intending couple, mm-hmm. if one of them is not committed. Yeah. And they will just do the games, playing, you know, they want fun and time, but they are not thinking of commitment, then that will already raise mistrust,
yeah.
and it will raise questions.
Yeah.
Even if this couple ends up in marriage, there will be that woundedness. So actually, almost divorce begins then, you know, when you're courting. Even before you get married, you could be preparing for a lifetime of love and fruitfulness, and or you could be already creating problems in your marriage, depending on how you relate to one another.
Yeah.
So the question would be, are you being open? Are you being sincere? Are you sharing clearly what are your fears?
Mm-hmm.
Why aren't you making this necessary commitment?
Mm-hmm.
And so when people come into marriage, they might come with this already pain and confusion and mistrust. And with mistrust, there will be disrespect. And of course, with all those games happening, one asks, do these young people or does this couple, can they define love? What is love to them, you know? And everything is actually often rooted way back, even in our childhood, you know? So marriage is a huge thing, but it's a huge thing rooted deeply in the family.
Yeah.
You know, so it's not easy, but it's true when you're committed and you're sincere and you're determined, then it seems easy.
Right.
Yeah.
Pastor Ayo, your church has gone public, you know, through a tweet saying that God does not allow or accept for divorce, and it should never happen. It's something that is not supposed to happen at all. But we have someone on Twitter who's actually saying that, you know, a marriage is a covenant between, it's like a contract between two people, and it can be terminated if the two parties agree to part ways. No big deal about it.
By the way, because I heard saying Pastor John is 29 years, and you are saying that you beat him with 1 year. Yesterday, by the grace of God, was our 17th year wedding anniversary.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm the junior.
Congratulations.
Congratulations.
Yeah. Yes, we need to look at the foundation of all things, and we look at the author of what you call marriage. Mm-hmm. When you have a machine, the manufacturer creates a manual for it. And you want to operate that machine very well, you must use the manual. When you don't use the manual, you will damage the machine.
Mm-hmm.
So marriage is like the machine that is created by God, who is the family God, because he is our father. And he has all of us as children. Do you understand? Now, with that, if you misplace the foundation of marriage, you will not be able to get the right result from it. Like that person that responded to the tweet saying that marriage is a contract. Marriage is not a contract, but a covenant. Do you understand? Contract, you can enter into the contract and terminate the contract. But marriage is not a contract, but a covenant.
Hmm.
And could you just substantiate that? Because probably he might not have got it properly. Because it feels like we agreed, and due to some circumstances, we are actually agreeing to separate. So what's the big deal with that?
So you see the, when I say covenant, God, you know, I told you, you must come from the manual of the machine. You understand? Mm-hmm. Now, God that is through marriage, saying that it's not good for man to live alone. I will create and help me for him. And in verse 24 of Genesis 2, he says there that for this cause, a man will leave his father mm-hmm. and join to his wife. Mm-hmm. There are no more two, but one.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Is that right?
Yeah.
So if you are one, you cannot break one. You understand? You cannot separate what is one.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So you totally say, no, there's no room, there's no window, there's
by
no
God door. That created it, there's no room for it.
There's no room for divorce.
Yeah.
Mary, before we come to you, John, do you also share the same thoughts?
I do. We need to understand we live in a broken world. And because it's a broken world, the issue, my brother is saying, of covenant is the right thing. It's the biblical way. It's when we understand God and God becomes the foundation of the marriage, then we understand a covenantal God, you know, which is here in Rwanda, we actually understand the issue of friendship by covenant, that it used to involve actually blood, you know. So it's a big thing, but the world is broken. And the God, the covenantal God, has bought us with such blood. When we understand him, then we are willing to enter marriage with that understanding. And right. There will be such deep commitment, there will be such deep trust. When you enter marriage and you're thinking contract, then there is no trust.
In fact, from the beginning, if you will enter with contract, you have set the time of breaking that contract later.
Right. Mm. Right. Mm-hmm.
You know, when I'm entering a contract, I have the option in my mind when I'm entering the contract.
Yeah.
I'm entering into this deal. If it's not, if I'm not pleased with it, I cut
then
it
I can walk out. But the agreed party, what I was asking is, so do you also agree that it is sealed? There should be never any room for walking out?
That's where I was going
yes.
by saying the world is broken, mm-hmm. you know? Because the world is broken, people have... A wrong misunderstanding. People are broken, and because people are broken, people will hurt one another, and they will not treat marriage as God sees it or as it is intended to be. So because of that, there will be divorces, and the people of God, the church, we who are working in marriage, we do not reject those people, but we realize it's a brokenness that breaks and hurts God immensely.
Do you have any instance where you're advising a couple and you opted to tell them, you know what, in this one, walk out, just divorce?
That never happens for any marriage counselor, because you draw your
regardless of whatever circumstances,
you draw your own conclusion. The only time we can say keep away is when there is physical abuse,
violence
is the right mm-hmm. word, you know, when there are threats that this person is in trouble mm-hmm. and they are in danger. Then we will say, okay, you can't be beaten every night, you can't be threatened to be killed every night. Mm-hmm. But even then, we believe that there is redemption and healing when the spouse is willing to undergo help and treatment, mm-hmm. you know. So there's been hope when people overcome their addictions and they overcome these behaviors, extreme anger, their own brokenness in their history, and there has been times when these couples come together. But because the world is broken, there have been others who have been divorced.
Yeah. Before we come to Pastor John, you said for you, no. But she says there's room. When there's violence involved, when there's physical abuse involved, we can actually advise pathways. Would you allow for that?
She said separation.
Separation.
She didn't say pathway.
Uh-huh.
That separation, I mean, I think she's mean temporary separation. You understand? Until we allow healing.
Uh-huh. Yes.
If I get all right. Uh-huh. So it's not that she's saying permanent separation.
Uh-huh.
You understand?
Uh-huh.
But that temporary separation so that you avoid the violence.
Right.
John, for some time.
Let me bring you in here, because under the laws of Rwanda, actually there are actually 8 grounds, sort of, that can allow one to file for divorce. And I just quote some of them here very briefly. One of them is the issue of, if someone is constantly committing adultery, then they can be able to file for divorce. One of the spouses can file for divorce. One can probably be excessively abusing or seriously inserting the other one. They can file for that. In what circumstances, apart from that, or do you also share the same school of thought that there should be no grounds at all for permanent separation? Let me not now use separation, because they seem to be hiding under that.
You know,
they don't want to hit, they don't want to call the spade a spade.
They are not yes. really hiding yes. behind that. I just wanted to come back to what Pastor Ayo mentioned. He quoted Genesis 2, I think 24.
Yeah.
Where God says, for that matter, man will leave his father and mother and be united with his wife. Mm-hmm. In fact, when you go to Matthew in the New Testament,
that's right,
chapter 19, verse 6, mm-hmm. when the Pharisees came to Jesus and they wanted to tempt him, to test him, with the claim of the Mosaic law,
yeah.
they said, what do you say about this? Because according to the law, Moses has allowed us to divorce our wives if they are caught in adultery.
Mm-hmm.
And Jesus said, haven't you read? In fact, he quoted Genesis 2:24, and actually he stated that for that matter, mm-hmm. what God has put together, mm-hmm. no man should put asunder. This is very, very critical. No man should separate what God has put together, neither any of the spouses shouldn't deal with this. However, when there are dangers, of course, like people have killed their spouses. In our context here, we have had a number of people killing or abusing, gender-based violence. We as a church, as a Christian leader, we want to advise them to separate temporarily as we speak to them. You know, I also want to mention that it depends on people who are around this couple.
Mm-hmm.
If people That's hang right. around people who have failed
That's right.
in marriage, if people stick to people who have had trouble in their marriages, I don't think they are going to encourage them to keep going. They will just say, you have tried your best anyway. We did not even expect you to stay all this long.
Mm.
So that's why I'm saying that we need to advise, we have advised actually couples to make sure they hang around people who have been able to persist in marriage,
mm-hmm.
to advise them.
But someone argues and says, you know, marriage is to be enjoyed. Marriage is not to persevere. I'm just persevering. You know, navumilia tu pale. I'm just, you know, ndikuihangana. People have to enjoy marriage. Why should we be persevering in marriage?
Yes, in the course of enjoying, we said in love. You know, marriage has to be built on love.
Mm-hmm.
And when we go back to what the Apostle Paul says about love, love is patient. You know, love endures a number of things. Actually, and he says that love covers a multitude of sins. With love, we can be able, we did not come all these many years because things were very perfect.
Mm-hmm.
But because our marriage is built on love, we accept one another, we accept each other, we forgive each other, you know. And then when things are not easy, we come around somebody who is senior like Mary.
Yeah, but Mary.
Listen to them.
You know, whoever is actually adulterous watching this show right now, or actually commits one or of these particular things that the law says one can be able to go and ask for divorce, might be seeing a loophole in keeping the trend of this behavior, because they're hearing you saying you can forgive, you can just hangana, you can just stay in there.
So the covenantal God we are talking about is actually the basis and the foundation of any marriage that we thrive, because the kuhangana or the forgiveness is very key. You know, it's very important. You cannot divorce it, if I use that word, from a marriage relationship.
Mm-hmm.
So first of all, we are drawn together in marriage because of love.
Mm-hmm.
But we know that love is most enduring. It's tried.
Mm-hmm.
And as we grow in this relationship, I acknowledge and realize that I'm human, with my own brokenness and with my own weakness, and my spouse acknowledges I come with these things that are not complete, and together we are learning on this journey, and during the learning there will be friction.
For how long?
There will be selfishness.
For how long do you keep forgiving? Forever.
Forever. That 70 will never
times
end.
7. Hmm? That's according that to Jesus.
That will never end. As God gives us the grace, 50 years, I don't know how many more times my husband will have forgiven me. Because we fail, we fail as human beings, But because of failure, because of forgiveness, because of enduring, that doesn't mean that marriage is not enjoyable.
Right.
Because it's the most intimate relationship that has ever happened. Right. It's the only thing that brings two people, and the Bible says, then they become one.
Right.
And in the process of becoming one, there are those frictions, But then it's enjoyable, and you can really rejoice in what you see, understand, learn from one another, because it can be the truest friendship. Mm. And friendship is very important.
Pastor Ayo, you seem to agree with that. But one of the things that is actually said here is enjoyment of marriage.
That's right.
And in marriage, one of the things that is to be enjoyed in marriage is also conjugal rights.
That's right.
And under the law, it is actually said that if a marriage is not followed by cohabitation within 1 year without reasonable grounds, it gives one of the spouses the right to lodge for divorce. Imagine, for a whole year, this spouse is not giving the other conjugal rights without any reason at all, which is actually has basis. Why should that couple still stay together? It may lead to cohabitation elsewhere outside of marriage. So the best option for them would be either to just separate instead of going to become adulterers out there. What do you think about that argument?
You are right, because we are human beings. But as I told you, the marriage, we must go, put this as and underline it, we must go always back to the manual. Do you understand? If you look at it, from that book of Matthew chapter 19, finally, Jesus told them, they asked, why did Moses allow us to release this bill of divorcement? Yeah. And Jesus said, in the beginning, it was not so.
Yeah.
What God created in the beginning, it wasn't so. He said, but Moses allows it because of the hardness of your heart. Mm-hmm. You understand? Mm-hmm. Because our heart is hardened as human beings. Mm-hmm. That's why someone can break his covenant. Because it is covenant. When you are coming to marriage relationship, it's covenant. So your conjugal rights, you understand, relation to one another is part of the covenant. So when someone, denies it, he has broken the covenant.
So what do you do?
So now when he has broken the covenant,
yes.
As Pastor John said, you must have some people that you are reporting to, you understand, that are nurturing you, and counseling you, and nurturing you in the right way. Number one. Number two, when the foundation is destroyed, you understand, it will be hard for you to mend it. So that's why, if you want to get into marriage, you must, as Pastor John earlier mentioned it, you must know where you are going before you enter into it. Yeah. Because many enter into marriage, you understand, just for the lust of the flesh. Mm-hmm. You understand? And when you satisfy the lust of the flesh, it could not be satisfied. So when this person has gone into the marriage and maybe he's not getting satisfied from this person, you understand? He cut off. But it's because the foundation, which is to be in God, was not there.
Right.
So if you make the God to be the foundation of the marriage, when you are entering into it, you must know your right. And covenant goes on with the responsibility.
All right.
Of the covenant.
Perfect. We're gonna hold our thoughts on that. And when we come back, he says it starts with the foundation. And it is a covenant. This is what we all agreeing before we go for the break. Mm-hmm. But when we come back, we're going to look at the issues of culture, our cultural values, and their impact on the marriage as an institution. We're going to talk about that. Mm-hmm. But of course, all we need you to do is keep those thoughts coming. I have so many tweets coming here. One of them is from Kabamba, John Bosco, who says, please, let's look for causes of the higher rate of it. Divorce never solves the problem, but creates another one. This is what he's actually saying. Another one from Frederick Onoka says, marriage is a lifetime commitment. We seeing divorce, especially when couples can't face or address their challenges. For example, unfaithfulness. That's one of them. Thank you so much. Sean, the DJ, thank you. Saying, nice show on a Sunday. Keep those thoughts coming our way. And of course, use the hashtag InFocusRW. I'll be able to sample them in the course of the program. Do stay with us. We're back in a moment.
Many people have been asking what we have been up to.
Well,
we have told the different stories from decision makers, but this time round, it will be different. We will be getting head to head with various influencers and get to the heart of the matter. It is not an easy ride, but we'll endeavor to get you there. It will be insightful, informative, and at times we will agree to disagree, because we are the bridge to your leaders.
Now that is the smell of a new day, new business ideas, new opportunities, and above all, a new chance to start over. Forget about the news. We want to talk about the stocks that are trading, what companies have been listed, and the exchange rate. And also the money matters, not just regionally, but also globally. Take a look. They are the right arm of every business world. The small-scale businesses, they contribute a lot to our economies, and yet they face new challenges every single day. Now, I come in to stop all that. Listen to them, find a common ground, and come up with a solution. And I also give you an insight into the opportunities in their business world.
Join us every Tuesday on Business Digest.
Thank you so much for still being with us. It is definitely In Focus. And of course, tonight our focus is on marriages and divorce. And our panelists are right here, of course, with their thoughts on this particular matter. And we're also sampling your comments on this one. We have Lonzen, who's actually saying, grounding the discourse in theology alone probably undermined its richness. Mm-hmm. Divorce is the same as adultery in the eyes of God. As usual, most Christians like to tweak the Bible in their favor. These are some of the thoughts that people are actually saying, that we seem to have just put it under theology to be able to actually have it to be substantial. But before we get even deeper into that particular perception, the role of culture, our cultural values. Pastor John, for example, your daughter is over 21 years, you know, and you are the one who actually mentioned the issue of time, that we, many couples are getting married without even spending more time to know each other and understand each other. But because the legal age is at 21, so they can get married, but because she's pregnant, you end up pushing them, because the culture says a girl cannot give birth when they're still at their parental home. How has this affected the issue that we're talking about today of marriages and divorce? Because we seem to be rushing to do weddings. Kuwera ya tweet. She's pregnant. So hurry up. Let's do this wedding before people get to know that you're pregnant. Our culture. Is it part of the reason?
Not only part of our culture, even the modern society, when a guy and a girl find that the girl is pregnant, they can even push it by themselves. Mm-hmm. How many times have these young people dictated on parents? You know, they set the date, they pay the hall for the reception, and they just come and announce to the parents.
Because she's pregnant. But it is because of the cultural belief.
Yeah, it is because of the culture.
So that's not them actually deciding.
This is what is causing problem. They are entering into marriage to conceal the pregnancy that took place. Mm-hmm. In the beginning, their love affair was not focusing on marriage.
Yes.
And so they are being pushed into marriage because of the pregnancy.
Yes.
And this is one of the reasons why we have marriages broken.
So what are you doing as you sit with these young people to talk about it, even 29 years after being, you know, in marriage? How can you people who actually know this have influence to be able to deal with this cultural issue?
It's not very easy, but in the first place, we encourage our youth to abstain from sex before marriage, because it's not acceptable. We encourage them to remain faithful until they get married. This is, in the first place, mm-hmm. our advice. People can relate to each other without necessarily having sexual relationship.
But that's not practical in many, it's not practical. Many youth. Mm-hmm.
That's what I'm coming to. In situations when it is not practical, people are dictating their ideas and their thinking into marriage. They are not considering the author of marriage, who has initiated marriage with a manual, which is the Bible. Mm-hmm. The Bible requires us to abstain from marriage. The Bible requires us to enjoy sex only within the marriage mm-hmm. relationship. Mm-hmm. And so we encourage our people to remain faithful to each other until they get married.
Yeah. But Mary, we are talking of the deed has happened. She is now pregnant.
Yes.
They had not planned to get married. But because culture says that, you know what, you cannot give birth when you're still at your parents' home, or your parents feel like they will be embarrassed if the society found out that you're pregnant, let's rush this wedding. We will even pay for it. Some parents go to that length of actually paying even the dowry and doing everything mm-hmm. so that this thing is off their back. So what do we do?
Actually, the issue is not just culture. Mm-hmm. If you look deeper, the issue there, it's a shame-based culture,
yeah.
you know? So it's not just like, say, Rwandan or Kenyan mm-hmm. or Nigerian mm-hmm. just mm-hmm. The root cause of the parents or the young person mm-hmm. going like, I've fallen, I am pregnant, I wasn't ready, let me find ways to cover it.
Yeah.
It's not just a cultural issue, it's a shame issue, which is also rooted in not being secure
yeah.
that I will still be loved
yeah.
for the child I am, I'll be forgiven, I will be supported in this. So when those things miss, then our young people, even our families, look for ways to cover up and to save face and to still look right and accepted. So it's overcoming that, actually, that foreign culture and knowing, I've done my best as a parent, but sorry, my child has been pushed by the winds of this world, and this is what has happened. And instead of me covering and still looking a wonderful mother, you know, and not feeling like I'm walking around and people saying, oh, poor lady, you are not really as good a mother as we thought, you know.
Should.
That's overcoming that, because that is deception, you know. Mm-hmm. And then my child or our children being able to know, we've fallen, this is not the end of me.
But Mary, you know, this is all theory, sweet words.
Yeah.
Tell me of someone who's able to actually stand up to that belief and just do what you're saying.
And now I know many.
Right.
I already know many. There are many families.
Things are changing
Who
a
have
bit.
Become, who have joined, I think, a team of strong families working on their families. And there are several things that show those kind of families. I think one of them is commitment to their family. So I am committed whether you measure up to my expectations or not, you know. The other one is being able to encourage, you know, to be able to look for the good and accentuate that, you know, than going like you're not measuring to what I want, and several other things. But one of the six things actually that describe strong families is that they have common, they are united in their belief, you know. So you can be my child and I'm a Christian, you know, you can't get pregnant, I've taught you to abstain from sex, but you haven't, and then you feel like, oh, now I can't measure up, so I will take a shortcut. But because you belong to these families that have committed to grow themselves to become strong, then you know you will be supported and loved against all odds. Mm-hmm. So it's not theory, it's not just sweet words, it's mm-hmm. happening mm-hmm. right here in Rwanda. Mm-hmm. I am witness, you know, that I know that there are many families who have supported their young people and actually encouraged them not to just rush into marriage just because they are pregnant.
Is this what, you know, all families should be doing?
Most families, there are some who sleep before they should be sleeping and they become pregnant and they are destined to live together. Mm-hmm. So we shouldn't say just because you are married, you're pregnant out of marriage, then you're not intended for this, for one another. But at the same time, you shouldn't just enter marriage just because you're pregnant, you know. Mm-hmm. So again, like Pastor John and my brother, I forget the name.
Pastor Ayo,
you know, said, when you have a community that surrounds, and that's the beauty of church, you know, because there you can find a community of people who will support you in every way possible, you know, who will work with you. And I'm so grateful because there are more churches who are learning and growing to support these kind of people, because our people have been shamed and cast away in our families and then in the church. But that is changing and it's a new day, you know. Mm-hmm. and that's hopeful. Mm-hmm. That's creating mm-hmm. hope. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But you said there are people who will surround you, encourage you, but Pastor Ayo, we also have people who will stigmatize you.
Right.
Just that's because right. you went through divorce, just because you're not able to sustain your past relationship, just because you're not able to keep in that first marriage. But you're already saying that it is wrong. It is not something that you encourage. So how do we deal with this issue of stigmatization of those who have slipped in their marriages and they have not been able, even with that time out that you have all said is what you do, not permanent separation, but, you know, periodic. What of those who have failed to even come back together and they're now shy of walking out there and loving again because they feel like the society will point a finger at them and say, look at him again or look at her again?
You see, we are in a culture that is we are in a culture what something we need to look at is we need to look at our value. Mm-hmm. We need to look at our belief. We need to look at our worldview. If you're looking at an environment where stigmatization means a lot, we have an environment where it doesn't mean I'm free, I'm on my own. Mm-hmm. And we have in an environment where you are actually living in a community, anything that happens, you are part of the community. And that part of the culture where you are part of the community also helps one from stepping outside mm-hmm. the bound and falling into such. But you are in an environment where you are just a freelance. And such, you understand, give a kind of license for someone to misbehave. And when such a person misbehaves, if you now move from such a community to another community where you are within the community band or ethics, you understand, of the community, and now you are stepping out of the ethics of the community, that's where that stigmatization comes in. Do you understand what I've explained?
You've lost me. Simplest terms. Talk to me like a two-year-old.
You know, let me just use an example. You are in this family. Mm-hmm. You know, you find yourself in the environment of another family. Uh-huh. They have different belief.
Yeah.
Do you understand?
Yes.
And then when you are now getting into another family, what has happened to you here, you want this other family to take care of it. It could be a problem.
Right.
Do you understand?
Right.
So now you must know what is your belief. In African setting, for instance, here, there is common belief in African setting. The common belief is the issue of respect. Is that right? Mm-hmm. Issue of, you know, there is norm in African setting. You understand? You can't just mess around mm-hmm. and you think that you are accepted in the community. Mm-hmm. So now, if you are stepping out of the norms of the society, mm-hmm. you understand? That stigma, get ready for it.
Right. So you have to be prepared to be stigmatized.
That's right.
No, but how do we deal with that? How do we deal with that? Because, look, Eugene, for example, yeah. you have been married for 29 years. Very good for you. You are a pastor. You lead a certain ministry, for example. Just because you feel that there's a certain level that the society looks at you, but back at home, when you're in your room, four walls are the only ones that know what happens in your room in terms of the fights that you have, in terms of the tears that you cry because of how unhappy you are in that relationship. Yeah. Now it's you hold back. You say, I'm not going to walk out of this because I will be stigmatized. They'll be like, pastor, even pastor. How do we deal with this issue of stigmatization if every option has failed and divorce is the only way out?
I think this stigmatization, this is where we step in as spiritual leaders. We need to listen to these people because they still need to be loved, because mm-hmm. they are going through hard times. It really hurts. You know, you can imagine somebody betraying you, disappointing you after a long journey of how many years, I don't know. Mm-hmm. It's like you have no other option. Mm-hmm. Actually, some people have gone ahead and committed suicide.
Yes.
But because these people can still be rehabilitated.
That's right.
Eugene, we have had people who have gone as far as even divorcing in the civil courts. But because they have been supported and loved and advised accordingly,
yes,
we have had people coming back together.
That's right.
I hope my colleagues agree with me. I have good number of them, good examples of them. After having difficult times apart, with good advice,
they came back together.
Yes, they came back together.
Isn't it because probably one of them was worried that that land, those houses, that property that I've worked so hard to get is gonna go?
No, this will never work.
This is actually what most people are actually arguing and saying, I'm just in there because I'm worried. She did not bring anything, but now she wants to go and she's gonna have half of it.
In most cases, what happened, even after they have had 50-50, mm-hmm. I'm talking about cases where people have had 50%, 50%,
and they still came back.
They still came back together. In this case, people have been convinced beyond doubt. You know, they have come back to their senses. Did you know that people divorce? They rush divorce mm-hmm. because they did not listen to good advice. A number of people have come to me mm-hmm. regretting, saying, "If I had known." Mm-hmm. A number of people who have gone through this process, they have come back to me and said, "Pastor, if I had known before, if I had people like you advising me and loving me and telling me how to go about these things, I shouldn't have gone into divorce."
Right.
So that's why I'm saying we need to listen to them. We need to love them. We need to care for them, because it's like they are abandoned by society. And through this process, if we can handle both sides of the spouses, by God's grace, God will intervene and some people.
But what Pastor Ayo said was that you need to prepare yourself.
No, when
would
I mean,
you like you to substantiate? Someone might read that as it's your problem.
No. You see, with what Pastor John said, I'll say that you are in a community.
Yeah.
And you must learn to live within the band of the norms of that community.
Yeah.
And that's where, when you mentioned about the church is part of the community. You know, and the one thing in the church is where there is no love outside. Somewhere where you can find such love is in the church. Mm. Do you understand? So that stigmatization, when you come to the church, you have some community that can accept you the way you are and also brush you up. You understand, and refocus you. Mm-hmm. So that's why, because you took us, you said that don't let us make it a kind of theological, but let us look at the culture. But we are in a complex society.
Yeah.
You understand? The theology is part of the society. Culture is part of the society. They were interwoven. Mm-hmm. You understand? You can't separate it. So that's why you must bring both together to be able to address this issue very well.
But how
so
do you bring
such person now that is facing stigmatization, where you get solution to such, come to the place where there is faith and where there is where such person can be reaffirmed, you understand, and be healed.
But how how do you reconcile a belief that since you're already pregnant, you have to get married immediately, you know, regardless of whether you two are ready or not, you have to get married, versus what he said, that most of the marriages, the couples actually rush into these marriages without actually preparing. How do we reconcile this? Because you said, yes, we have people who are already doing this. But are they doing it in silence, in little cocoons, in little groups? Or is it something that people should now start walking out there, go to parliament, petition the lawmakers, or whoever, cultural leaders, to be able to work out that particular situation? And how easy will even that be, John?
That's a very, very sensitive issue. And I think we need to change our mindset. We need to change our way of looking at things. Even given what culture has been telling us in the past, we need to come to a point whereby we agree that any pregnancy should result into a marriage. I mean, these young people, they don't even know sometimes what they're doing. They just want to discover what is hidden in there without knowing exactly what is coming out. But their focus was not to get married.
Yeah.
So we need to educate our young people. And we have cases where...
Or educate the older people who are actually making them to believe that once pregnant, go married.
No, we need to change that thing, because our modern times today with the government of Rwanda in this context, where we have laws protecting people in this regard, there have been young girls who have got pregnant, they have gone ahead and had their babies, they have gone back to school, graduated, and later on, or sooner or later, they will come across a man that really loved these people, and they get married and they live happily, which was not the case in the African traditional culture.
Right.
You know, it was abominable to go with somebody who has had a baby.
Right.
But today, this is not the case.
Right.
And
right.
So that's why I'm encouraging our viewers or our fellow citizens that we need to get out of this kind of thinking. We analyze case by case. Yes, some pregnancies can come in the course of preparing the marriage. In this case, they can go ahead and get married because they love each other, they are committed to each other.
Along the way,
that's the foundation.
But if it was just by accident, we should step in and say, hey,
are you ready for this?
Are you ready or you are not ready? And people have confessed we are not ready. I have had people tell me, yes, I got pregnant, but I don't have to go ahead with this affair with this guy.
Let's bring in our viewers once again, those who are tweeting us. Emma, thank you so much for tweeting. You say, by culture, society will support you in marriage preparations, but won't work with you after you tie the knot. The ball rolls between you, the two of you. Let me address this one. Shooting Babazi says that a panelist from youth demographic is necessary to this topic. They are majority and struggling most. Thank you for that feedback, but it's too late for now. We usually post this particular topics early. I would like us to have people suggesting that I have someone who would be very good for your topic, and I would definitely bring them in when it is early enough. But right now, we are 49 minutes into the show, really too late for this particular suggestion, Lucy. Thank you for that, though. There's another one also from... Lucy again, which says that I've learned last year that 80% of cases in our courts are divorce cases. What are the reasons people give? Probably you've handled this in terms of those who actually want to end into divorce. What are the reasons that they give you?
Yeah, in fact, we raised some of these issues in the book we wrote a couple of years ago.
Yeah.
One, there are a number of them. One, we have monitored a number of couples. They don't really have time to talk about their issues.
Yeah.
Communication problem. You know, every time there is an issue arising, people should have good time to talk about these issues before they pile.
Yeah.
If you wait for issues to pile up, you are waiting for an explosion someday. This is one of them. Mm-hmm. Secondly is management of finances at home. Some people have decided to reserve an upper hand in the management of finances. There have been people who own bank accounts without their spouses knowing about this, mm-hmm. you know? And this is, you are creating a mistrust in your spouse, somebody yeah. you are going to work with for mm-hmm. quite a long time. You know, you are creating an insecurity in this person, and so these issues have created problems.
Right.
There are also cultural reasons.
Right.
There are people who still think that because I'm related to everybody, they will come and dictate in my house.
Mm. Mm-hmm.
They want to take an upper hand detecting what my wife should be doing in the house.
Mm.
Because you are my brother, you are my uncle,
or
you are my auntie, or my mother-in-law. You know, these issues are also creating problems.
Mm.
We have handled people who were almost on the verge of divorcing because they have no room. They have no room of breathing. And some spouses, especially men, let me talk about this. Men, you know, they don't want to have problems with their relatives. And so they let their relatives do whatever they want to their wives.
In their houses.
In their houses. Mm. This should not be the same, the way it should be done.
Right.
Life together in marriage should be two people.
Right.
Is maybe this realistic, they can also add on a few.
I'm sure you're a mother, right? And most of the time, mother-in-law have always been pointed as the major problems of stabilities in homes. But he says that marriages have to be for two people and let them, give them the space. But how realistic is this with our culture of welcoming people in our homes? And as you say that, you could also share with us some of the issues that the people you minister to in the marriage ministry bring to you as their major problems. Perhaps our audience can be able to relate and handle their own issues back at home.
The issues are very similar to what he has said. The issue of communication, the issue of handling finances. It's a real big issue of relating well to the extended family.
Mm-hmm.
But some of my experience have to do with actually more hidden kind of issues, like not obvious.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you can't name it and say it's not communication, you know. It is miscommunication, not being able to listen to one another, but there are underlying issues.
Mm-hmm.
And the underlying issues have to do that actually people have come into marriage broken, if I may use the word, you know.
Mm.
They have their own brokenness in the past, including the issue you mentioned in our law that says if they deny one another
conjugal rights,
you know, there are always underlying issues. So when we come into marriage, we are actually making this commitment to make the other person better. You know, when we come with that understanding, actually marriage will work, you know. But most of them come and already thinking, I know I'm broken, make me better, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And then the other person is kind of looking, I am also broken. I was hoping you make me better. So enabling them to actually communicate to a deeper issue of what are the underlying issues here? What are your problems, you know? We've talked to couples where the guy can't just relate to his wife just because he was abused all along his life. He's very hard uncle who raised him, called him all kinds of names, kicked him, beat him. Now he's in this marriage and he's like, how do people love, you know? And it's so demanding, and then he just shuts up.
Right.
He just keeps quiet. So the question saying the all the relatives come and they say whatever they can, he just has no clue.
Right.
It's not like he doesn't love his wife. It's not like he wants to end this marriage. So those are issues. The other issues are actually when people run away from reality and then they hide in other things.
Mm.
They become addicted, you know. So there are actually even couples, spouses, who cheat on their spouses, not because they hate them, not because they are not fulfilled, just because they are broken. So in our relationship to couples, we are looking deeply into that issue. Come on, there is hope for you, you know. You can become whole. Some issues are really deep. People have to seek professional counseling and they have to be willing to invest finances. But there are issues where many lay counselors in the church can actually handle and help couples communicate on a deeper issue.
Right.
Be able to find out, why are you holding on your little finances? Why are you keeping your personal bank account when you went to Murenje and signed otherwise? You know, what is the problem? Why are you so silent when your kids are even at risk of being abused in your own house?
So you have to talk.
Yeah.
Thank you so much, Mary. As we go, Pastor Ayo, where do we go from here?
Some of the other causes could be gossip. There are a lot of people involved in gossip.
Mm-hmm.
You understand? Talking,
the people you listen to.
The people you are listening to.
Right.
Can break. And then wrong comparison. The marriages
are different.
Different.
And unique.
Unique.
That's your parting word.
So
don't listen to what people are
don't
saying.
Don't listen to, don't use this person's marriage
say you
as a
be
copy
like
for mine.
Right.
And then want to like that. So this guy, the way he takes his wife out, you must take me out.
Mm-hmm.
You must do
we
this. You must buy
that.
This for me.
Right.
You understand? Mm-hmm. Work within the uniqueness of your own home.
Right.
You understand? And then you won't have run into problem.
Perfect. Thank you so much. Just final tweets right here. Mbabazi says that timelines should be introduced to marriages combining wealth. People divorcing in 2 months, taking half. That doesn't make sense. All right? Thank you so much for all these tweets. Keep them coming. The conversation ends here, but it has to continue online. Let's keep talking. The hashtag is InFocusRW, trending at number one as we speak. Let's keep that conversation going on. Let's keep exchanging. And I'd like to request for your advice when we are preparing for the next shows. Kindly give me the suggestions. If you have a panelist, you'd love to be on this conversation that we're preparing for the next Sunday. Just feel free to suggest. Even your own self. Just say, I'm willing to come on that panel, because you don't know how difficult it is for me to get 3 people on this panel. It's never easy. So thank you so much for watching. Thank you for your contributions. And always, my name is Eugene. Anangwe. Goodbye for now.